Today, I will discuss the topic statistics. First of all, what do you mean by statistics? Is statistics is a subject? Is statistics is a device? Or what is statistics? So first, I am going to discuss what is statistics. We generally take statistics is a device for collecting data and for developing technique for their analysis to draw a inference from them. Generally, we mean statistics is a device, a tool, a technique. Using that technique, you can collect the information or data. You also can analyze the data and finally draw a conclusion what your findings. So that is statistics. Remember that the word statistics end with the letter S. So it may be used sometimes in singular sense, sometime in plural sense. For example, if we said this year our result statistics shows that the students are performing very well. So in this case, statistics means collection of a large number of data on results. So the sense here is plural. On the other hand, if we say this is a very good introductory book on statistics, in this case the statistics is used as a subject, so the sense of the statistics is here singular. So the last thing about statistics is that data. If you have no data, then statistics cannot do anything. So that is why statistics is a device for collecting data and analyzing the data and drawing inference from the analysis. So that is statistics. So nowadays, without data, you cannot give any information. So data is a huge role. Now I am going to discuss types of data. Depending on source of data, it may be either primary or secondary. Primary data is sometimes also known as raw data. The data which is collected by the investigator himself from the field of inquiry is called primary data. For example, a doctor records the weight and blood pressure of the patient in his own chamber, so this information is primary to him as he collects the information directly. On the other hand, secondary data sometimes also be termed as prepared data. Prepared data বা কম্বাইন ডেটা। ইন দিস কেস দ্য ইনফরমেশান হ্যাজ অলরেডি বিন কালেক্টেড বাই সাম ওয়ান অ্যান্ড ইউজড বাই আদার ওয়ান। সো দ্য নেক্সট পার্সন হু ইউজ দ্য ইনফরমেশান কালেক্টেড বাই আদার ওয়ান, দ্যাট মিনস হি ইউজ সেকেন্ডারি ডেটা। সো ডিপেন্ডিং অন সোর্স দ্য ডেটা মে বি প্রাইমারি অর সেকেন্ডারি। Now, depending on characteristics of data, data may be quantitative or qualitative. What is quantitative data? Information or data which can express numerically the data is called quantitative data. In statistics we use quantitative data with a term which is called variable. So variable is a data or information which can be expressed in numbers. A information or a data which can express in number is called variable. On the other hand, qualitative data which cannot be expressed numerically is qualitative data. In statistics it is termed as attribute. I am going to give some examples on variable and attribute. You want to record the height, weight, age of the students of your class. So you see that the height, weight, age, all the character can be expressed in numbers. So age, weight, height are the examples of variable which can express in numbers. On the other hand, you want to record the religion and caste and mother tongue of your students. All the characters like religion, caste, mother tongue of the students cannot be expressed in numbers. So they are called qualitative data or attribute. So I think it is very clear then what is attribute. Attribute is the characteristics which cannot be expressed in number. The examples are religion, caste, nationality, also the mother tongue, economic status, educational qualification, economic status like below poverty line, poor, middle class, rich, etc. On the other hand, educational qualification like primary pass, secondary pass, higher secondary pass, graduate, postgraduate, doctorate, these cannot be expressed in numbers. So remember that one interesting thing you will see in your mark sheet, the number received by the students, score in every subject is an example as it is expressed in numbers. The score, marks obtained by the student in the examination is an example of variable. On the other hand, grade is denoted by the some alphabets like B, C, A, O, very good, good, outstanding, excellent. Eglo hocche tar meaning, that these are the meanings. So grades are the example of attributes, where the marks are the example of variables. But our concentration will be on the variables. seen in mathematics, without number we cannot do anything. So our discussion should be concentrated on variables. Again, variable can be two types, either continuous or discrete. Continuous or discrete. What is continuous variable? Continuous variable is a variable which can take any number, within its range of variation. It can take any number within its range of variation. For example, if you consider the height of a man in the world is minimum is 2 feet. Let us consider that two feet, and the maximum height of a man in the world is 8 feet. So the height of the man or person may be any figure within 2 feet and 8 feet. So like height, time, temperature, these are the variables which can take any number within a range. For example, the minimum number recorded in the earth is -70 degrees, and maximum number is recorded is 60 degrees Celsius. So the temperature of any place may be any figure in between this. So this is an example of continuous variable which can take any value within the range of variation. Remember that actually continuous variable can take uncountably infinite numbers in the range of variation. So note it. It can take uncountably infinite numbers. Uncountably infinite numbers. Now, what is discrete variable? Discrete variable is a variable which can take some isolated values from the range of variation. So, discrete variable can take some isolated values within range of variation. That means it cannot take any value. What are the example? The very simple example is family size. Example, family size. What does the family size means? Family size means number of members in the family. Number of members in a family. Can you ever heard about the things, the family size? My family size is 2.5. If you have a, 3.5. If you have a little sister or brother, you have to count as a single person. So remember that 3.5 cannot be the family size. It may be either 2, either 3, or 4, or 5, etc., etc. Number of students in your class cannot be any value within 1 to 30. Let us consider the maximum size of your class is 30. So depending on the number of students present in the class, it may be either 0, that means there are no students in your class, maybe 1, maybe 2, maybe 3. You know, in between any two numbers there exist infinite values. When you are asked how many numbers are there in between 1 and 2, you know there are infinite values within two numbers. So in this case, the variable number of students in the present in the class only takes some integers. He ignores all infinite number of values in between any two values. It only selects some integer. That is why the discrete variable is a variable which takes only some isolated values. Now there is some fallacy. Sir, discrete variable takes only finite values. I am giving some examples. Family size. So size of a family cannot be infinite. Let's take an example. Number of trees in India. Number of trees in India. What is this? You can start the count of the number, count of the trees from your nearest place. The count starts like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and so on. Remember that there are infinite many values in between 1 and 2, but in this case this variable takes only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, but you don't know where to stop. That means what is the total number of trees in India? This is obviously infinite, as well as number of stars in the sky is an example where discrete variable can take infinitely many values. So remember that discrete variable can take finite, it can take finite or infinitely many values. Another interesting question is there: is discrete variable is always integer? The types of example which I have given to you indicates that the discrete variable always takes integer. But remember that in the definition it cannot says that it takes only integer. I have an example which can clears that a discrete variable may take some fraction value. For example, 10 questions are there in a question paper. All are MCQ. And marks for each question is 0.5. There is no negative marking. Now, what are the possible marks obtained by a student? Out of 10 questions, a student fails to do any correct question. That means he can get 0. If he get only one correct question, he will get 0.5. If he give two correct question, he will get one. If he gives three correct question, he will get 1.5, 2, 2.5, 3, 3.5, 4, 4.5, and if he able to give all the question correctly, answer of the question correctly, then he will get 5. Now look at the number of possible marks obtained by the students. It is either 0 or 0.5 or 1 or 1.5. So that means a collection of few integers and fractions. But in this case, he cannot get 0.25. He cannot get 1.99. So that is why I am saying that a discrete variable may take some fraction only. One confusion is there, sir. The exam system, which in the exam system where we getting score marks out of 100, is this a discrete variable or continuous variable? Remember that you can get any value between 0 to 100, but we have no system to give scores like 25.25, 25.3, etc. You know, if you get 24.5, then the marks will be converted to 25. So this is our system, but remember that marks obtained in a normal examination is always a continuous variable. Now you can represent the data by several ways, by some text, by some table, or by some diagram. You can represent a data by some text. Generally, the newspaper organization gives some information using some text. This is not very popular. So this is one of the method to represent any data which is using some language, some text. And this is very popular to you, to represent data by a table. This is called tabular presentation of data. And the very, very popular mode of presentation of data is diagrammatic representation of data, or you can also say graphical representation of data. That means you can represent the data by some graphs or diagram. Remember that this mode of representation has a long lasting impression in human beings. So that is why this mode of presentation is very popular. Now I am going to discuss how to represent data by a table. So that is why, depending on presentation, data, that means variable, I have already said that our discussion concentrates on variable. Variable again can be two types. Frequency type, non-frequency type. Frequency type, non-frequency type. What is frequency? Frequency means number of repetition of a value, of values of a variable. Let the family size, you are conducting a survey in your locality on family size. Family size it may possible in a house there lived a single person, so family size is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, let maximum is 5. So you know, using tally marks, what is tally marks? You know, using tally marks you can prepare a table which can represent the frequency. Frequency is number of repetition. You see that the value 1, that is there is a two family, there are two families which has a member 1, so the corresponding frequency will be 2. There are 5 such family, so the value 2 repeats 5 times, so 5 represents the number of repetition of that value, and so on. So always frequency is nothing but number of repetition of such value. Now you can get the family size of a locality are 1, 2, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. You have surveyed only 10 houses and you see that every house has distinct number of members. So in this case, the no value is repeated. So that is why when you wrote this information, this is a non-frequency data as no value is repeated. So remember that frequency means number of repetition of a value. Remember that since the discrete variable cannot take any value within the range of variation, to prepare a frequency table, you have to take single value as a group, and corresponding frequency and tally marks are noted in the respective columns. I think few of them know how to represent frequency table. Someone is asking me, can you write, sir, in this way 1, 2, 3, 3, 2, 6 and onwards? No, you cannot prepare class for discrete variable. So when you prepare a frequency distribution table is nothing but a table where the values of the variable is written with corresponding frequencies are called frequency distribution table. So again I am repeating that a table which reflects the values of the variable along with their frequency is called frequency table. So remember that you cannot write in this way in a class form. Why we cannot write in a class form? In this class we mean that a value can be any value in between 1 and 3. So there exist infinitely many value in between 1 and 3. So you know, family size cannot take any value in between 1 and 3. It only takes some integers, 1, 2 or 3. So that is why it has to be remembered. That is why discrete variable to prepare a frequency distribution table of a discrete variable. Values of variable, you cannot prepare a class. You can write the individual value as a different group and write the frequencies correspondingly. So this is called summation of frequency. Remember that n represents total frequency. Total frequency is sum of all frequencies. Sum of all frequencies. Again, I am repeating that do not prepare class for discrete frequency distribution table. You can prepare a frequency distribution table for discrete variable taking the individual value as a single group. So this type of frequency table is called simple frequency distribution, simple or ungrouped. Ungrouped frequency distribution, simple or ungrouped frequency distribution, simple or ungrouped frequency distribution. So simple and ungrouped or ungrouped frequency distribution always connected with the discrete variable. But if you have a values of a continuous variable, then what will happen? You have learned that a continuous variable can take infinitely many values within range of variation. So actually a continuous value take infinitely many values. Now if you try to prepare a frequency distribution in this way, that means writing a single individual value as a group. So since it is an infinite, it can take infinite many values. So the purpose of prepare frequency distribution table will be hampered. What is the purpose of prepare a frequency distribution table? To represent the data in a well condensed manner. That means when looking at a single time on the table, you have an idea about the whole information. So when you prepare a frequency distribution for a continuous variable taking individual value as a group, so then the frequency distribution table looks like a Chitragupta khata. Chitragupta khata bole na je bishal boro khata, tar mane amara ekta ei table ta ekta page e amra complete korte parbo na, eta jano page er por page cholbe, kan infinitely many values are there. So that is why to represent the frequency of a continuous variable in a table, here you have to think about group or class. Here you have to think about group or class. So now I am going to give some definition, various definition connected with frequency distribution of a continuous variable. Try to write the definition, then I am going to discuss, then I am given some example of a continuous frequency distribution. So I think you know what is class. Class is nothing but a group. the whole set of data of a continuous variable can be divided into number of groups, and these groups are called class. Next, the definition of class interval. Class interval says that the whole range of the variable values, remember that all the terms are connected with continuous variable only and frequency distribution of a continuous variable only. Range of a variable values is divided into some groups. These groups are called already class in the group means in the form of interval. In the forms of intervals, each interval is called class interval. Each interval is called class interval. Each interval is called class interval. Then class frequency. Number 2 is class interval. Number 3 is class frequency. Class frequency means number of observations included in a class is termed as frequency of that class. Next definition is class limits. Now the two topics, there are some confusion about class limits and class boundaries. I will give some example. So first write what is class limits. Class limits are, these are the two endpoints. These are the two endpoints of a class interval used for tally marking the given values. However, these limits do not show
the real boundaries of the class.
Real boundaries of the class.
Just write the definition. I am going to explain. So, what is class boundary? The two real endpoints of class interval are called class boundaries. The two real endpoints of a class interval are called class boundaries.
Stop here. I also give some definition, but you have to develop some idea what I am already saying.
Class, if you see the marks obtained by
the students of your class out of 100 marks
are varies from 5 to different marks are there, maximum is number 99. So there are so many students. You can write the individual value of the students. So first of all, one of the important thing is range of this data is maximum minus minimum value. This is also very important
definition. Range of a variable means maxima minus minima, that is the length of the data.
So in this case 99 minus 5, it is 94.
Generally you will be asked to prepare a frequency table having 10 classes and etc., sometimes 8 classes etc., etc. But depending on the range of the variable, you can easily distribute the marks into 10 groups like 1 to 10, 11 to 20, and proceeding in this way 91 to 100. So these are nothing but class intervals.
Number of class is here 10, and
class intervals, number of class,
and these are called class intervals. This is the first class interval, second class interval, and the 10th class intervals. So number of class is 10, and these intervals are called class intervals. First class interval, second class interval, and last class interval.
Now every class interval, for every class interval, you will see that there are two endpoints. For the first class interval, the two endpoints are 1 and 10, For the second class interval, the endpoints are 11 and 20. And for the 10th, that is last class interval, the endpoints are 91 and 100. So, for the first class interval, one is also endpoint, 10 is also endpoint. So for the first class interval, one is called lower class limits. I have already given you the definition of class limits. These are the two endpoints of a class interval. Lower class limit and it will be the upper class limit. So for every class interval, there are lower class limit and upper class limit. So for the second class interval, 11 is the lower class limit, 20 is the upper class limit. For the last class interval, 91 is the lower class limit and 100 is the upper class limit. Now, since the type of the data is continuous data, though you cannot generally get 10.5 or 20.5 such kind of marks. But looking at the sense of the data, since the marks obtained by the student is continuous, the scores of a student may be 10.5 or 20.5 or 90.5 hotei patto. কিন্তু আমরা দেই না বলে সেটা হবে না, তার কথা নয়, হতেই পারত। ধরো কোনো কোনো এক্সাম সিস্টেমে আছে রাউন্ডিং অফসটা করা হয় না, নেক্সট ইন্টিজারে কনভার্ট করা হয় না। সো ক্লিয়ারলি সি দ্যাট ইউ ক্যান নট রিপ্রেজেন্ট দ্যাট ফিগার 10.5 অর 20.5 ইন দিজ ইন্টারভেলস। এখানে টেনিস ইউ হ্যাভ এন্ড উইথ দিস ক্লাস 10 and start with this class by 11. So you cannot represent the figure 10.5 or 20.5 these in these class intervals. So that is why what I am saying already, the class limits are not the actual endpoint of the class. Since you are dealing continuous variable, your class must be continuous, your classes must be continuous. So that is why you have to prepare a class boundaries. The rule of the prepare class boundary is that identify a D. What is D? D is the difference between upper class limits and lower class limits of any two consecutive classes. So in this case, clearly see that D is equal to 1. Here D is equal to 1. You take any two consecutive classes, let it be first and second. Now the difference between the upper class limit and lower class limit is 1. In this case, it will be 20, it will be 21. So the difference between upper class limit and lower class limit of two consecutive classes is always 1 in this case.
So then the rule is, to prepare a upper class boundary, generally we write this as UCB. In this way, UCB is UCL. UCL stands for upper class limit. Upper class limit plus D by 2. And similarly, you will get lower class boundary, that is LCB, as LCL minus D by 2. LCL minus D by 2. So in this case D is 1. So D by 2 is equal to 0.5. So prepare class boundaries from class limits. Just subtract 0.5 from the lower class limits and add 0.5 with the upper class limit. Then you will get class boundaries like 0.5 to 10.5, 10.5 to 20.5, 20.5 to 30.5, and finally 90.5 to 100.5. So now there is a continuation. Now one of the obvious question, sir, always we have to subtract 0.5 to get a lower class boundary from the lower class limit, or always we have to add 0.5 to get upper class boundary from the upper class limit? The answer will be no. That depends on the value of D. Remember that D is the difference between upper class limit and lower class limit of the two consecutive class. The value of D may not be 1, it may be any other value. I can give you an example where D is not 1. So remember that some of the students thinks that to prepare a class boundary from the class limit, blindly subtract 0.5 from the lower class limit and add 0.5 with upper class limit, then it may be wrong. I am given an example where the D is not 1, so then you have to remember. But in your syllabus you cannot get such kind of data. But what I am telling, that to prepare a frequency distribution table and to write class boundaries from the class limit, always identify the value, always identify the value D, then calculate D by 2, and to get upper class boundary and lower class boundary, then accordingly subtract D by 2 and add D by 2. So take this example, class limits. Class limits is 6.5 to 7.4, 7.5 to 8.4, 8.5 to 10.4, and 10.5 to 11.4.
and 11.5 to 12.4. So clearly see that these are no actual endpoints, since the remember that you are dealing with continuous variable. Any value may be 7.49. So any value which is 7.45, it cannot be entered in any class interval. You know, here the class entry is 7.4, but it starts with 7.5. So values like 7.45, 7.49, 7.4776, these values cannot be included in this class interval. So that means these are the class limits. We have to find class boundaries first. Class boundaries. So in this case, clearly see that the value of D, what is the difference between upper class limit and lower class limit of any two consecutive classes? Take any two consecutive classes, let it be third and fourth. The gap between the lower class boundary and upper class boundary of any two consecutive classes is in this case 0.1. So d by 2 equals to in this case 0.1 by 2, that is 0.05. So what is the formula to get lower class boundary? You have to subtract the value of d by 2 in this case, which is 0.05, and to get the upper class boundary you have to add upper class limit plus 0.05 in this case, since the d by 2 is 0.05, minus 0.05 from here, so then you will get 6.45, and add 0.45 here, 7.45, subtract 0.05 from here. Now you clearly see that the classes are continuous, there is no break. So that is why what I am saying that when you prepare a class boundaries from the class limits, do not blindly subtract 0.5 from the lower class limit, and do not add always 0.5 with upper class limit to get upper class boundary. So your first task is to identify the value of D, where D is the difference between upper class limit and lower class limit of two consecutive classes. Now one of the important thing is that, sir, if the values of a variable appears to be 8.45 or 7.45, so then what will be the in which class interval it has to be included? In which class interval, here or here? Relate the values of the variable here is 7.45, so here to include, in the first class or the second class? If it is be 8.45, then where to include it, in second class or third class? Now remember this rule, the name of this rule is called left inclusion rule. To enter the value in the class, you have to remember that if x is the value of the variable, it may be greater than equals to lower class boundary, but strictly less than upper class boundary. So that means when the value of 7.45, in value of x is 7.45, so you cannot enter here. You know, 7.45, the value cannot be equals to upper class boundary of that classes. It always less than upper class boundary of these classes. So that is why again 7.45, again 7.45 is the lower class boundary of the second class. So 7.45 may be equals to the lower class boundary or greater than that. So that means 7.45 must be included in these classes. 8.45 will be included in these classes. So remember this root left inclusion law. So where the values of variable always greater than equal to lower class boundary but less than upper class boundary. So where we stop, we are given some definition. So class, I have given last definition as class boundaries. Last definition as class boundaries. So class boundaries means the actual endpoint of the classes. You can add sentence with class boundaries that clearly upper class boundary of a class, upper class boundary of a class coincides with the lower class boundary of the next class. It is obvious, you have already seen that. And remember that the class boundaries are the actual endpoints. So that is why class boundaries are used for forming forming the frequency distribution frequency distribution of a continuous variable. So remember that when you prepare a frequency distribution table to represent the raw data of a continuous variable in a table, always you have to find the class boundaries. Then that means your tables looks like your formation of a table will be in this way: class limits, then class boundaries, then tally marks, and finally the frequency. Tally marks and finally the frequency. So class boundaries has to be used. Class boundaries have to be used for forming the frequency distribution table. Otherwise you will lost some information. Why I am saying that? Otherwise you will lost some information. Without making class boundaries, if the value of a variable is 4.75, you lost the data. When you prepare a class boundary from the class limits, then you can locate this data on the second class. So remember that your frequency table must be start with class limit, then class boundaries. Can this helps you to for preparation of frequency distribution table. And telemarks is not is used, you know that telemarks is used to calculate frequency, it helps to calculate frequency. So when you deal a large amount of data, then telemarks will help you to prepare to count the frequency. Now another important definitions are class mark or mid value. The mid value or class mark of a class is equals to, either you can write upper class boundary plus lower class boundary by 2, or it may be equals to upper class limit plus lower class limit by 2. You can verify that both will give the same value. Either upper class boundary plus lower class boundary by 2, or lower class limit by lower upper class limit. Lower class limit by 2. So you can say that halfway between the two endpoints. Next is class width. Class width is, remember that class width is difference between upper class boundary minus lower class boundary. Difference between two actual endpoints. Remember that it not equals to upper class limit minus lower class limit. It not equals to that. You have to identify the difference between two actual endpoints. So class width is nothing but difference between upper and lower boundaries of class interval. Sometimes it is also called size of the class. Next definition is frequency density equals to class frequency divided by width of the class interval. Frequency density is class frequency divided by width of the width of the class interval. And another definition is there, that is relative frequency equals to frequency of the class, that is class frequency divided by total frequency. You have to remember that sum of the frequency, if you add all the frequency of the classes, then you will get total frequency. So that is why total frequency is the sum of the all class frequencies. In notation, total frequency is denoted by n, and the term, this is called summation iron from 1 to n,
over A5. Later I will discuss that. I will end the class with the term which is relative cumulative frequency. Let us consider a class, let it be class boundaries. Class boundaries starting from thirty point five, forty point five, fifty point five, sixty point five, and seventy point five, and corresponding frequencies are let it be 5, 8, 10, 12, 7. So the total frequency is let it be 8, it is 9. So 5 plus 9 is 14, 14 plus 8 is 22. 22 plus 11 is 33, plus 7 is 40. Verify that 8 plus 8 16, 16 plus 9 is 25, plus 3 30, 40. So total is 40. So cumulative frequency is nothing but cumulative total of the frequency. Cumulative total means conjugative summation, conjugative addition. You can conjugatively add the frequency from upper to down or down to upper. From the first class to last class, again from the last class to first class. So that is why cumulative frequency, I am writing the frequency in the shorter version. It may be two types. So cumulative frequency may be two types. Either it will be less than type, or more than type. Sometimes it is called less than type, greater than type. Accepted. Less than type or greater than type. Less than type, more than type, less than type, greater than type, all are similar, greater than, less than type, greater than type. So less than type cumulative frequency generally denoted in this way, CF less than type equation. That means you have to add the frequency from first to last class, that is 5 5 plus 4 is 14 14 plus 8 is 22 20 plus 11 is 33 33 plus 7 is 40. And one of the important thing you have to remember that the cumulative frequency less than type for the last class must be equal to the total frequency. Again, you will get notation of less than type frequency is this, and notation of more than type frequency is this. So adding the frequency consecutively from last class to first class, that gives you 7, 18, 7, 18. Next is 16, 25, again, sorry, 35 and 40. Again, you see that
cumulative frequency greater than type for the first class must be coincide with total frequency. So when you prepare a cumulative distribution table, then you can verify your calculation is right or wrong. So remember that less than type cumulative frequency at the last class, for the last class, must coincide with the total frequency, and cumulative frequency of the more than type is must coincide with total frequency for the first class. What does the cumulative frequency 14 indicates? Let these are the scores of the students. That means there are 14 students whose score is, to explain the 14, we need a help of the upper class boundary of the second class. 14 is the cumulative frequency less than type for the second class. To explain what is 14, I take a help of upper class boundary of the second class. So remember that to explain lower less than cumulative frequency of a class, the upper class boundary of that class is connected with that. How? 14 means there are 14 students whose score are less than 40.5.
In this case, it cannot be equal.
Less than 40.5.
Again, 16, what does 16 indicates? 16 students are there whose score is more than or equal to 40.5. So that is why to explain cumulative frequency more than type of a class, you need a help of lower class boundary of that class. So from here you clearly see that there are 16 such students whose score is more than or equal to 40.5. So only you know how to calculate less than type frequency and more than type frequency, that is not enough. You have to identify what does cumulative frequency explain. Ki explain kore eta tomake kintu clear hote hobe. Ami abar repeat korchi, to explain less than type cumulative frequency of a class, you need the help of upper class boundary of that particular class. That means here 22 is clearly means that there are 22 such student whose score is less than 50.5. So 22 is the less than type cumulative frequency of the third class. 50.5 is the upper class boundary of the third class. So to explain 22, I take the help of 50.5. So similarly, if you say that more than cumulative frequency of the second class is 35, that means there are 35 such students whose score is more than or equal to 30.5. And one last thing, what I have to mention, that this is a very interesting relation. You can see that frequency of a class equals to cumulative frequency less than type
plus cumulative frequency more than type of the class sum of cumulative frequency less than type or more than type of the class minus total frequency. You can verify. Let 8 is the frequency of the third class. 8 is the frequency of the third class. Dekho, clearly 8 is gettable, but 8 is obtained from where? 22 plus 16 minus 40. 22 plus 16 is 30. What I am? 22 plus
this is wrongly written. It will be 26.
26 plus 20. I have wrongly written that. 7 plus 11 is 18. 18 plus 8 is 26. 26 plus 9 is 35. So sum of the more than type and cumulative frequency and less than type frequency minus total frequency always gives you the frequency of that class. You have to remember this relation. I think I have covered the topic of statistics up to revision test. The graphical presentation of the data using different graphs like frequency polygon, frequency histogram, and other diagrams are in the third monthly syllabus. So that is the end of my class.